Hey everyone, this is Dr. Qazi, and in this video, we are going to learn about the drugs, the medications which you take through the oral inhalations or the nasal inhalation. And finally, what is the intrathecal, topical, and the transdermal route of drug administration? The oral inhalation, as the name suggests, are the drug, the medication which you take through the oral route or the oral inhalations. Have a look at this diagram. You might have seen the asthma patient, the patient who cannot breathe because their airways are constricted, the air passages to the lung are blocked. Now, in order to open it up or dilate the airways, the asthma patient used this plastic shaped structure known as the nebulizer. Now, they inhale the drug through the oral route and the drug is reached directly at the site of infection or the problem. If the bronchioles are constricted, we use bronchodilators. The examples are the bronchodilators and the corticosteroid. One very important advantage of this oral inhalation is the rapid drug delivery, because the surface area of your lungs is increased by the pulmonary epithelium and the mucous membrane. So this will cause the drug to rapidly reach into your systemic circulation. Now, the nasal inhalations are the medications which you take directly through your nose. For example, if you have the stuffy nose and you want to get rid of this nose congestion, so you will use the nose decongestant, which will open up your stuffy nose. The famous example is the oxymetazoline. It's a drug which you take to the oral route, nasal route, and it will open up the nasal congestions. The very famous and the interesting example is diabetes patients. The desmopressin medication is administered through the nasal route. Now, you want to deliver the drug into your brain, into your central nervous system, but the problem is the blood-brain barrier. You cannot cross the blood-brain barrier. Now, what is the blood-brain barrier? Have a look at this diagram. We know that our whole brain is surrounded by lots of capillaries which are providing the oxygenated blood, the oxygen, to the brain structures, the brain tissues. Now, the drug, the medication cannot cross this blood-brain barrier. Have a look. This is the wall of the capillary. The blood is flowing to the capillaries. Notice the tight junction between these endothelial cells of the capillaries. Because of these tight junctions, the medication which is flowing in the blood cannot reach these astrocyte foot processes. So how will you deliver the drug into your central nervous system? You can do that by using the intraventricular or the intrathecal route of drug administration. So what is the intraventricular route? Have a look at this diagram. You inject the drug directly into your cerebrospinal fluid. The cerebrospinal fluid is surrounding your brain, your cerebellum, your spinal cord. So when you inject the drug into your cerebrospinal fluid, the drug is administered directly into your brain, because the cerebrospinal fluid and the cerebrum are in direct contact. So rapid drug delivery to your central nervous system. The example is the amphotericin B drug used to treat the cryptococcal meningitis. Now, sometimes you need the local effect of the drug. We have the fungal infection on the skin. You have to get rid of this fungal infection. You will apply the cream, the ointment, directly on the skin infection, on the fungal infection. So the example is clotrimazole cream, apply on the skin and get rid of your fungal infection. Now, the transdermal route is the application of the drug directly on the skin by the use of transdermal patch. Now, the advantage of this transdermal route is the sustained drug delivery. Slow drug delivery, but sustained drug delivery into your systemic circulation. The example are the nitroglycerin and the antiemetic drugs. Now, the rectal route, the 50% of your rectal drainage doesn't cross the liver. So the medications which you take through the rectum have more efficacy. In other words, it is more effective as comparison to the other route. But the question is, why we use the rectal route? Sometimes the patient is unconscious. You cannot give him the drug orally because it may go into his lungs and cause, you know, blockage. So we administer the drug to the rectal route because the blood supply of the rectum is very perfuse. It is absorbed very quickly. Now, in order to explain the venous drainage of the rectal route, have a look at this diagram. The rectum is drained by three veins: the superior rectal vein, the middle rectal vein, and the inferior rectal vein. The superior rectal vein is drained into this inferior mesenteric vein. This inferior mesenteric vein is connected with the portal vein and it will reach the liver. The drug which is passing through this superior rectal vein into the inferior mesenteric vein and eventually into the liver will go to the first pass metabolism. But the drugs which are absorbed to the middle rectal vein or the inferior rectal vein doesn't go into the liver. They bypass the liver. They are drained into this internal iliac arteries on both sides and directly into the inferior vena cava. In this way, 50% of the drainage bypass the liver and the first pass metabolism is reduced by half. This is all about the various routes of drug administration. In the next video, we are going to learn about the absorption of the drug. Please do like, share, and subscribe, and I will see you in the next video.